Hi, I'm Julian, and this is the WLB podcast. WLB stands for Women-Led Businesses. The reason I started this podcast is because I was able to see a pattern in the circle of my friends. There were so many women who had turned ideas into full-fledged businesses. Some were working on it on the side, while some were still setting it up. But they all hoped to create meaningful businesses, which were not just profitable, but also added value to the society we live in. Through this podcast, we will be talking about what inspired them to start, what kept them going, and what more they envision for their businesses in the future. I have been a software developer by profession so far, and I've always been fascinated by such novel ideas that plug in so well into our economy and the society as we know it. Like, you know how you never thought you wanted it, but now that you know about it, you can't live without it? Well, through every episode, I hope to share the story behind such businesses, to create more support for women-led businesses, and to inspire more women to start their own businesses. Women-led businesses. Today we have with us Akriti Mittal, who has her Instagram page, which has the name Theory Handmade Colors. And the one reason it caught my eye was because of those beautiful reels and the pictures that are posted with all of those colors. I've not seen stuff like this before, so I was definitely curious, and I'm sure everybody who is listening to this also would love to know the story behind this, who is running this, and what inspired you to start. So welcome on board. Thank you so much for joining us. So begin with your introduction. Let us know who you are and what you do.
Great. So I'll just start, by introducing myself. So my name is Akriti Mittal. I am basically an engineer plus MBA, the very cliche career I've had. I did my engineering in instrumentation. I'm currently based out of Gujarat. And then I went on for my marketing degree at Narsimonji, Mumbai. After that, I also had a corporate job. I worked there for about 1 year and moved on to, work from home thing. However, all this while, I was still connected to art in some or the other way. Like, I had not given up on it even when I was in my, say, 10th standard or 12th standard, and then moving on to BTech and then MBA as well. Mm-hmm. So every time there was a touch with the every medium. In fact, the first oil painting that I did was when I was in my 7th standard. I was basically 13, 14 years old. So I always, liked doing it, and my parents were also supportive. So that's how it began. And because I started, I explored acrylics, I explored oils, and this was at the last stage that I explored watercolors. Usually it happens the other way around. People usually start with watercolors and then move on to other mediums. However, for me, watercolors was the one that I explored at the end. And how it started was because I was getting recommendations and everything in Instagram, and I was observing that, okay, this is some very versatile medium that gives you amazing results on paper. And I wasn't able to do that with oils or acrylics. So that's how I started painting with watercolors. Slowly, as I, improved my artworks and so on, I wanted more colors. I wanted more options. But I wanted them to be in my budget. And I thought, okay, let me try making some of my own. So I started making some of my own, and I also started using them. Basically, selling them was never an option to me. I always wanted to use them for myself. It's just that when people started reading my captions and they liked the shades, then because I got those, you know, those queries and everything, then I started thinking, okay, maybe I can sell these. So that's how it started, basically. Selling was never an option, but I'm glad how it worked out.
That's awesome. Like, okay. For like, I think from the till the BTEC level, we are pretty much similar. So I was thinking, okay, the journey was the same, but this is really fascinating. So do you still work in your corporate job, or do you train full time?
So after work from home, I was very frustrated because the 8-hour working thing had now gone into 12 hours working thing, and I was not comfortable.
Ask me what.
So I really did not want that. Plus, I was more frustrated because it was eating up my my own personal time, and I was not getting enough time to paint or create the content that I wanted to. So that was the basic reason that I left my job, because I wanted time out for myself. And then I started full-fledged painting, and started creating content, videos. My Pinterest hit 1 million viewers. So I was working on that. And that was all everything, as an artist, not as a paint maker. So that started, and moving on to, because I had to support myself now that I did not have a job. So I had to monetize this thing. So selling paints became a great idea. However, I have only, started about, 4 months back.
Oh, nice, nice.
But I did leave my job about 6-7 months ago. So
nice.
Yeah,
it does take guts to do everything during 2020. Like,
I had a pros and cons list as to should I leave my job, should I not leave my job, because the job after MBA is a handsome job, and it was very difficult to sort of make that decision that okay, I should leave it.
So during your work hours and your college, like you mentioned, you loved painting. Do you, I would actually like to go a little bit back. Do you ever go for a class? Did you learn how to draw and paint?
Yeah. Not for watercolors, but the basic training I did have in school, and I was very fortunate enough to have a great teacher back in school. And there was another, so there were basically two teachers, and they had their own studio as well. So because of that, I had an opportunity that beyond school hours, I could go there and I could learn.
So that is
how I could move on to it, even professionally. Otherwise, I would have probably ended it with just being a student.
This happened all the way in school, like that's bachpan.
All the way in school. After 10th standard, I have not attended any class or anything. I did subscribe to Skillshare, great content to learn from artists all over the world. So I started using Skillshare about 1 or 2 years back. And that's kept me inspired, because after a while you hit an artist's block and you don't know if you want to explore your style or try something else. So Skillshare has really helped me amp up the skills.
Oh, nice. I had no idea. So when you talk about Pinterest as well, like I think for a lot of people in India, still Pinterest is very new. And but everybody else outside is like crazy and like this is the place to go make a board and all
exactly.
That. So can you tell me how do you discover that and how do you start?
So even I thought that, you know, Instagram is everything, Pinterest is nothing. That was the typical mindset I also had. However, I was posting content on Pinterest also because I was getting ideas and I was getting inspired. So I wanted to share it back because that's the perfect way to go. That if you are copying or, you know, getting inspired from some artist's work, it's kind of considered to be a good thing if you share it back. So that is what I was doing basically. And then I created a video of my own and it started showing some great analytics. And that hit me. Why? So I thought, okay, let's try this. And as I started posting new content, it kept on increasing. And some of the videos got featured. Some of them went viral on Pinterest. Wow. So that's when it hit me, okay, that Pinterest is a great idea, you know, to sort of share your artworks. And now I'm in a position that people are sort of getting inspired through my original artworks and sharing it with me.
Back. So, oh, yeah. Nice.
So it that is great. Sweet. So yeah, I do want to, you know, if anyone's listening, I do want them to sort of explore a world beyond Instagram. You know, Instagram algorithms always changing and then people getting upset that why is no one saving and all this. So Pinterest is a great, great option.
I mean, I've always, so whenever there's a shopping to do or some decor ideas, that's when I actually go to Pinterest. But it's very recently, like I have like DIY hacks and how to make wall art. So I think it's like
videos do a great job on Pinterest, much more than Reels do on Instagram, I guess. I mean, that's how it's been for me. I can't say for everyone.
Sure. So, I mean, I'm not a very social media person. It's just recently that I've actually come to Instagram also. So, how do you deal with all of the analytics? Like, you have to, like, on Pinterest, and like, you have so much analysis, so many numbers. Do you feel these numbers, like, how do you deal with them? Is it overwhelming or has it taken the fun out of your life? What is your state on that?
You know, initially, as like everyone else, I was also intimidated by Instagram that why is this post not doing well? And I had people sending me those links in DM that, you know, those follow things. And I never liked that. I'm like, you need to genuinely like my artwork. I don't want to engage with this. So, yeah, I did feel, you know, sort of how I felt lost. I did not, you know, sort of feel bad or good about anything. I just felt lost because I couldn't understand that why is this doing well and this not doing well. So that's when, you know, I thought, okay, let it go. It's fine. I am not going to be able to figure that out. For Pinterest, I did figure it out. Videos are a content that do amazingly well on Pinterest. I'm also starting to, you know, slowly understand that why will a certain video pick up. It's just that people want a content that, you know, they can replicate or they can learn from, or probably change the shades and, you know, sort of make it again. They don't want to look at your photographs and look at something that probably they cannot learn from, because that is the kind of audience that I have. I do not have audiences who are going to buy my art. I have an audience who is of probably, you know, student nature who want to create something like that. So understanding my audience has sort of really worked out for me. If I notch it up, I started including captions in the middle of my videos, you know, to sort of help them out as to let this particular thing dry and then paint it over and all those things. So those videos do even more well. So that is how analytics have actually helped me. I'm not really overwhelmed with them.
Does the MBA help in that?
Yeah, definitely. I have used full marketing skills in my theory shop. I am only thinking of, marketing ways, and really, God bless my social media marketing professor. But yeah, I'm using those things to use.
Nice. So did you research a lot on making a paint? It's like something very new to me. So I was like mind blown. Now people are not going to Camlin. They are actually buying from a Instagram store. To actually get that, I was like, it took me a while to get that. So how do you do this? Like, do you research on what materials to buy and what's your process? Like, did it take months to figure out what worked, or was it naturally?
So it took me about 3 months to figure out the perfect recipe. Basically, so the best part is that it's all organic. There's no chemicals or anything involved.
Wow.
So it took, basically there are two things. You have a pigment and you have a binder. And the binder is organic. So that took me a while to figure out the recipe, because each pigment is going to behave differently. Each color has a different property. You need to figure out that what kind of raw materials you need to get the perfect consistency, so that sometimes the color ends up being lumpy, it doesn't dry up, and sometimes it dries up so much that it gets cracks and everything. So that was the difficult part. After a while, I started understanding this color needs this much, this color needs this much, and the binder has to be this way so that it's going to work for all the colors. Took me about 3 months to figure that out. What helped me in this period of time was vlogs by various color makers. I would like to sort of name some of these. There's Stuck Kiwi watercolors. I think they're based off of New Zealand. Amazing job they do, and that person really shares every insight in her blog, and that's been really helpful. Also, there are some people, I was in the initial stages where I was making color for myself, so there are people like that also who keep experimenting, and they will put those videos up on YouTube, so you can know that what is going to not work, and then you can eliminate those things and sort of figure it out yourself. So those things have really helped me. God bless internet.
Seriously, I'm just thinking of the same. Like, you are in India and they are all the way across the globe.
None of these people are Indians. None of them.
Wow. So I think we should be, and we are a very fortunate generation to actually get access to all of this. So anybody in your family is working along with you on this to help you promote this more, or is it what do you have word of mouth sales as well? Do people who use it?
So my sister, actually, I have a younger sister. She is a designer herself. She sort of gives me, very aesthetic ideas about how to put stuff on Instagram, or, sort of colors that people would like. So I get a lot of ideas from her. However, for working and all, physically, it's just me, a single-handed thing that I currently do.
Nice. So when you decided to quit your job and do this, was that process also was your family supportive of this? I remember you saying they were supportive of the fact that you paint acrylic and oil.
Yeah. My family was definitely supportive. In fact, I come from a business family, so my father was actually glad that I was venturing into of my own small little business. And he's always, from the start, he was always like, oh, then you do have an opportunity. Oh, then you can really expand. I'm like, yes, I can. So he was very supportive. And for the sort of the raw materials that I needed or something that I needed to get manufactured. He's really sort of helped me out in all those things. Because I couldn't, being alone working in this, it was very difficult for me to sort of have a standard packaging, you know, the boxes and everything. Plus, I wanted them at a cheaper rate. So I couldn't just buy them off Amazon because I wanted the wholesale rate. So my family has really helped me out in those things.
That's awesome. Like, I mean, I think a lot of artists have this struggle to, you know, first convince their family, like, this is a thing that I can, that can actually support me, that people will have a demand for. So that's really nice to have your parents on board.
Yes.
That's great. So when did you know, like, this is the right time, like, this, I should definitely start now? Or, like, what was that deciding factor?
So the breaking point was for me was to whether leave my job or not. That was the breaking point. And after that, everything was smooth sailing. How I came to that decision that, okay, let's, you know, sort of do this, was when it started taking over my mental health and my peace. And I was at home. So I made sure that I have enough savings for myself. That was the first thing. Because, you know, sort of leaving your job and venturing into something new that you don't know is going to work or is not going to work. And especially a field like this, which is actually very difficult to sort of monetize also. So that was the first thing that, okay, I have enough savings. Let's try something out. Second thing was that I backed it up with a freelance teacher kind of a job. And I also started taking painting workshops. So that is something, you know, that supports me that, okay, I have a backup. That was an important thing to have. And after I made sure that, okay, I have a safety net, then I had the guts to, okay, let's do this.
Nice. So did people ask you for your paints? Like, I just remember you mentioning that specifically. What's like?
So, like, when I started using them, and, you know, in caption we usually put that what are the materials or the paper, the brushes, the color that we're using. So I used to mention that this is something that's been made by my own, and these were the colors that, you know, you wouldn't really see in a Camden or a Brusso 24 or a 36 set of colors. This was something new. So that's when, you know, people started approaching that, where did you get this? Or how did you make this? And they wanted some for their own.
Yeah, I mean, I love your colors. They're like out of this world. I'm like, what I'm seeing in the in nature is almost like you're trying to replicate nature. I was like, how do you do this galaxy level colors and all? That's amazing.
Thank you.
Do you have like any inspiration for that? Like, do you like travel to places or, you know? I remember you mentioned the blogs and the YouTube videos, but personally, is there a story behind every color? This is referring to that, or this is what I feel right now, so let me make red or orange.
So I sort of did a therapeutic arts coach, and I got certified for that. So one of the main things in there is about colors, because colors have a sort of a healing property. And, you know, I think most of us would have read that this color signifies this, like red signifies love and yellow is like a color of joy and all those things. So yeah, it definitely affects your mood, like the color that you're around. And, you know, people want to have light color in their homes, not sort of a dark color. So yeah, colors definitely affect your mood. And this was something that after I learned and I got certified for, I had a better understanding and perspective of how to go about it. So, but I personally wanted to include all the colors. I wanted to have all the colors available in, you know, my shade card. So I don't have a particular bending towards one color, because I want all of them to be sort of available.
Nice. I mean, I think there are some colors that you can't describe, like, you know, when you go look for it also online only. Right. I want something that looks like mud, but it is not mud. So, but then when you look through things like that you share, it's like, first, like, for people who don't understand what color goes with what, that's a different challenge altogether. But right. Shape, as if you mention them, it's very nice to have that handy. And I think, who are your biggest people? Like, are they students, or are they what kind of, like, do you have analytics on that? Who buys these things?
Yeah, so I said, for as an artist also and as a paint maker also, majority of my audience is students and student like customers, you know, sort of building on this, or are hobby artists. I think lockdown gave me a very good opportunity, because a lot of people started exploring their creative side. So I have a lot of customers like that also. And I talked to some of them, and they say that, you know, they started exploring in the lockdown, and they are sort of interested, and they want to, you know, explore with more colors. So they try out my colors, because it's something new, you know. You find some shimmer colors. It's not just a plain matte color. The colors are shiny if you look them in sunlight. So people really like those kind of things. So yeah, that's my basic audience. Yeah,
so if you look back on 2020, it has been a blessing in disguise.
Definitely. It's been a blessing in disguise, otherwise I'm pretty sure I would have been sitting in office.
So that's a very nice way to see this. So did you spend time, like, how much time do you spend doing this? Like, would you tell me, like, how long does it take to actually create one thing that you're satisfied with? Okay, it took me 4 hours, or how is it that?
So like I said, you know, after 3 months, after you figure it out, it's not a very sort of a tedious process. I have everything written down, that if I have to make this color, this is the amount of pigment, this is the amount of binder that I need. Sort of a recipe book instead of cooking recipe book. That is the one that I can easily refer to. So after that, it becomes an easier process. It becomes a relaxing process, I would say. Because, you know, when you're sort of mulling the color, and you know, it's very, very relaxing to sort of see that. I have even been trying to make the satisfying videos, because when those colors, the golden color drips, now people really like it. And it's basically the same for me. So I really enjoy the whole process of making a particular color. If you talk about, sort of making one color at a time, it really depends on the quantity that I'm using. So for example, I'm using 25 grams of pigment at a particular time. It would take me about half an hour to 45 minutes to sort of mull it and give the pans their first fillings. So the fillings are not done all together. I need to fill them in about 3 to 4 layers, otherwise they do not dry up properly. So yeah, basically getting these pans ready is a journey of 2 to 3 days, because then I have to wait for them to dry up and then fill them again.
Oh, there's a lot of theory in this. So, like, I mean, there's a lot of technical details in this, like mulling, and these are all new words to me. And I think people with experience and, you know, who have used this would understand this. So Do you, is there a story behind this name? Why do you choose this name, Theory, the hand shop?
So main reason was, basically it was a contrast. It's something very practical. There's no theory in it. But if you see now, it always starts at the basic. And this is like, theory is always the core of anything you do. So, like, talking an engineer to an engineer, if you're going to a physics lab, you need to know the theory first. And then you will be, you know, handling the wires and everything. So that was the sort of an essence, that it's something that is, I want it to be at the core for an artist and as an artist. So that's the inspiration that I had behind the name.
So do you sell your artworks as well? Is that also...
I do not sell my artworks, but I do take commissions. So I have people, you know, who sort of couples, or if they want a wedding card or a birthday card, an artwork made, customized. So I do those things.
Okay. So do you have a website where you write, where you mention all of this customized works available? Because
my website is still in the making. I will be publishing it very soon.
Sure.
However, I need to figure out, it's sort of ready, but, you know, I think publishing my website is going to take another shot of courage, because I don't know if I'm going to be able to handle the crowd and single-handedly. So maybe after I figure out my logistics and if I want to involve more people in the company, and then I will be.
Nice. Sure. No, I mean, creating a website also is everything needs effort. So whenever you are out with it, do let me know. So I'll be putting up links to all of this, because I think people need to, what I'm trying to do is make people aware about these things. And what excites me actually is I just love the hearing stories and what actually made you do this. So hearing about this is actually a wonderful thing for me, and understanding that, wow, things like this can also be done. So about the timing of this, when you decided to launch these paints, did people ask for colors and did people ask for papers and brushes as well, or was there a demand only for the colors?
The demand was for more and more and more colors only. I went from 2 colors to 6 colors to 24 colors, and I still had people asking for, can we have this shade and can we have this shade? And if it was not about the color, it was about the size. For example, if I'm selling in half pans, can we have it in a quarter pan, or can we have it as a dot size? So yeah, the demand is always for colors. I started with shimmers, so then I started getting requests for neons, then I started getting major requests for pastels and so on.
So nice. So how do you envision your growth? Would you stick to colors, or would you start selling anything else along with this?
No, I am sort of trying to expand, because I also have a thing for aesthetics. So, you know, when I sort of make an artwork and I am clicking a flat lay photography or something like that, I want to have those accessories. I love to have them, you know, sort of washi tapes and brush rests and mixing plates. So those are the things that we will be expanding very soon, probably with the ceramics or resins. But yeah, basically a one-stop solution that people can have to these things, which are currently not very easily available. And if they are, they're super expensive, which they do not have to be.
Okay, that's nice. So, does anybody have has anybody guided you through this entire process, or has it always been in the internet, the blogs and the videos of other artists? Has anybody been in your family who has guided you through this?
No, there hasn't been really sort of guidance towards the technicalities. However, for the financial part and all, I do have to, sort of take references or take guidance for those matter. For the technical part, mostly, it's been my inspiration, and I think as an artist, I that has really helped me, because I get the problems that I faced myself, and the things that I want myself are the things that I'm sort of trying to introduce to everyone. So that's been the most inspiration that I get.
So talking about problems, what were your biggest challenges all throughout this?
sourcing raw material for this thing is the biggest issue. Because even if in India, I am from a particular supplier, I'm getting a few colors. The problem will be that even though I am getting a particular color, either it will go out of stock in a few days, or I will not get a lot of color options. I cannot limit my palette to only 6 colors. Like, I want to provide options right now. Currently, I have 25 shimmer shades and other neons plus pastels and mattes. So I still want to expand these 25 colors, right? So getting the color plus maintaining the quality of all these colors, because they're all coming from a different supplier. So that was the biggest issue. Another issue was, although lockdown has been great to me, I think it's also been kind of negative, because now if I want to import something, it becomes very difficult. Considering that most of the cheap things come from China, becomes very difficult, because I cannot import from China now. So I'm getting them from US, and it's costing me a lot. So yeah, it works both ways, you know. It's the good part of lockdown and the bad part of
about the shipping? Was there a delay in shipping? Did your customers experience any delay?
No, shipping has not really been an issue. Shipping, like, is a general issue to me, because I stay in a tier 3 city, and shipping directly adds like 1-2 days naturally, because reaching a proper city first and then sending it is easy. Like, you can easily get your products if you're shipping it from Mumbai, Delhi, something like that. I stay in a tier 3 city. Sending it out to a major city itself takes 1-2 days. So I have to sort of explain it to people, and you know, if they get angry, then I get anxious. That is like a general problem I still have.
So basically, these, whenever this thing happens, are the reviews on this on online, do you feel a drop in numbers because of this? Has anything, like, we're not having enough colors?
I've been fortunate with that. People do understand that, yeah, it's a small business. Logistics can be an issue. It's something not in my control, right? After I ship your product, my responsibility is that I ship it as soon as I can. And I have upgraded my shipping to the best possible that I have currently. I've upgraded to an integrator which sends my customer live updates on SMS and email as to where is the product, or has it been picked up, or is it getting delivered. So I've notched it up to the best possible way, and people understand that even if there is a delay now, it is not in my hands. They do put me a DM, or they sort of message me that it's been delayed, can you please check it. And I do check it, and I do put in a complaint if there is a delay. But I've never, had an enraged customer that, why is my order not here? I think I'm very fortunate that way. And I would like to have it that way.
Sure, definitely. So do you think people are more supportive of the fact that, so what I would want to understand is, like, currently, what I'm trying to find is, like, women are very creative. Like, creating paints is like something I would never think of. So, but then I'm discovering these things. Like, there are people are selling masalas, people are selling paints. Now, you have brushes being sold, and I'm like reaching out to be like, God, how do you do all of these things? And plus, sometimes there is a huge number of people who are doing this. But then sometimes I feel that investors don't want to invest in thing in businesses owned by women. So do you think there's a reluctance of people, women coming up and showing ki, I have a business, or I am a business owner? Is there any reluctance in terms of the fact that, do you think women actually are a bit shy and they don't want to be labeled as a business owner? Or is there anything, any tug of war, internal tug of war that happens?
So personally, I have actually not met anyone who's sort of had this kind of an issue or who's been reluctant to come up with their own ideas. In fact, you know, like multiple times in a single day, I get approached by girls. Okay, I'm not even saying the word women. I'm saying girls. They approach me with the sort of some are creating stickers or some are creating journals or handmade paper. They approach me on a daily basis as to please try a product and please put them as either freebies or sell them on the on your shop. Because they are still trying to sort of build it up. So if you have that kind of an enthusiasm when you're a girl, when you're studying, you're still not over, you know, with your academics or your career has not yet begun. I think times are changing now. Yeah, the power of social media is there. And I think because they already see that, like if I... Like, how did I get my courage was that I saw that, okay, people are doing this and they are able to do this. So I think it's like a cycle that look at them, get inspired and, you know, carry on. So it goes with the upcoming, you know, generations also. So I think, yeah, times are changing. I can't really say about the investment part here, but from the viewpoint that I have, women and in fact girls are not at all reluctant in coming up with their ideas and trying to monetize it.
That's really nice. So that actually is encouraging. So I feel I think your family's been very supportive, but if you were to, if somebody's listening there who has an unsupportive family or business is a, you know, it's a taboo and you're supposed to have a job first and focus on, you know, building your career there, what would be your, you know, 2 cents to them, like how to go about it? But their heart is in business and maybe they really want to start that.
You know, if you're, so basically, I don't believe in putting up a fight or anything. I just believe in finding your own way by hook or crook. So do what they want you to do. You still have your personal time to do what you want to do. So if I were ever put in that kind of a situation, I would still, you know, sneak in 1 hour or 2 hours for myself and do what I want to do. And because I'm very, you know, sort of confident in something that I'm doing, or because my heart's in it, like you said, it would grow. Like nothing's going to be stagnant. It is going to grow if you're doing it well and if you're doing it honestly. And as your family starts to see something that is growing, definitely they're going to support you. So yeah, the starting period is going to be difficult. It could be difficult. It does not necessarily have to be. But yeah, you just have to find your way and, you know, sneak in 1 or 2 hours of difficulty and hard work. But yeah, you can do it. I absolutely do not believe in putting up a fight and, you know, going with the, no, I want to do this. This is I don't believe in that.
That's nice. So thank you so much for joining us. I am really happy to actually have connected with you. I hope to get the word across and wish you all the success. Like, expand a lot more, keep doing this, don't even think of quitting, because this all seeing all of these colors on reels itself makes me very happy. So thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
All right, wish you all the best.
Thanks a lot. Have a great day.
You too. Bye.